Welcome, everyone. I'm Tom Truxton. I think I know everybody in here already, so that's good to see some familiar faces. A couple announcements. We have the nursing home ministry coming up this Saturday, the 28th. So if those of you haven't ever done that before, I'd encourage you at some point to at least give it a try. I know talking with the SOD students, when they've done it for the first time, it seems like they've always, or some of them, have always come back to me and mentioned, you know, how blessed they were just because it was something they were really scared to do the first time. But after doing it once, it was like, wow. I mean, I thought I was going to go in there and bless those old ladies and those old men type thing, but they came out of there being blessed themselves. So it is a really cool experience. Sometimes you see kids in there, and it's okay to take your kids too if you want. The people, the residents really like it when you bring the actual young children in there. Also, this coming Sunday is a baptism. So our monthly baptism is going to be this Sunday, the 29th, last Sunday of the month. So before we actually jump into the scripture reading, let's go ahead and pray. Heavenly Father, we thank you, Lord, for this evening. Lord, we thank you for the ladies, the study taking place in the sanctuary. Lord, we just pray for everyone in attendance, men and women alike, and for the youth that are doing their thing tonight as well. Lord, that you would just bless us all. I pray, as I mentioned earlier in a different prayer time, that it would be cool that the men and the women alike, they'd be able to leave the teaching tonight with some sort of nugget of scripture or wisdom that they heard that they can take home and share with a spouse maybe that wasn't able to come tonight, or a family member or a child. And maybe it'll create some sort of word study that they would look up something that they hadn't thought of before. So maybe this will trigger some sort of a deeper devotion. So Lord, we just pray that you would allow that to happen, and Lord, just bless our time together tonight. Whatever questions and feedback we may have after the teaching, may that be a blessed time as well. And Lord, just protect us going home tonight. Safe travels. Lord, we just pray all these things in Jesus Christ's name. And everyone said, amen. Amen. All right. I was going to read verses 1 through 13, but I didn't bring my Bible, so I want to ask one of you guys to read it out loud like we've done before. I've got all the scripture references that I need for the teaching. I just didn't bring my Bible when I got out of the car. So anybody want to read for us verses 1 through 13? Okay, Joel?
Now Joshua, the son of Nun, sent out two men from the Acacia Grove to spy secretly, saying, go view the land, especially Jericho. So they went and came to the house of a harlot named Rahab and lodged there. And it was told the king of Jericho, saying, behold, men have come here tonight, and the children of Israel, to search out the country. So the king of Jericho sent to Rahab, saying, bring up the men who have come to you, who have entered your house, for they have come to search out all the country. Then the women took the two men and hid them. So she said, yes, the men came to me, but I did not know where they were from. And it happened as the gate was being shut, and it was dark, that the men went out. Where the men went, I do not know. Pursue them quickly, or you may overtake them. But she had brought them up in the roof and hidden them with the stalks of flax, which she had laid in order on the roof. Then the men pursued them by the road to the Jordan, to the fords, and as soon as those who pursued them had gone, they shut the gate. She had gone out, they shut the gate. Now before they lay down, she came up to them on the roof and said to the men, I know the Lord has given you the land, that the terror has fallen on us, and all the inhabitants of the land are faint-hearted because of you. For we have heard how the Lord dried up the water of the Red Sea for you when you came out of Egypt, and what you did to the two kings of the Amorites who were on the other side of the Jordan, Sihon and Og, whom you utterly destroyed. And as soon as we heard these things, our hearts melted, neither did there remain any more courage in anyone because of you. For the Lord your God, he is God in heaven above and on earth. Now therefore I beg you, swear to me by the Lord, since I have shown you kindness, that he will show kindness to my father's house, give me a true token, and spare my father, my mother, my brothers, my sisters, and all they have, and deliver our lives from death.
All right. Thank you for reading that. You can see that's about halfway through this chapter, so next week we will finish up the rest of chapter 2. But this evening we have, I think, a pretty cool study. I'm excited about sharing it with you. Hopefully you feel the same way at the end of it. But just reading through verse 1, I came up with about 6 or 7 different questions just in the very first verse. And that's what I don't often do as much as I should. And, you know, when you really have to do a study like this to prepare and to teach and to share it with someone else, you really inevitably go a little bit deeper than you normally would on your personal prayer time or just devotional reading. I think you would attest to that. Anytime you have to teach something, you actually learn a lot more of it. I know those of you that have ever been in a situation where you had to teach something to somebody else, you probably understand what I'm saying. So in verse 1, alone, "Now Joshua the son of Nun sent out 2 men from Acacia Grove to spy secretly, saying, 'Go, view the land, especially Jericho.' So they went and came to the house of a harlot named Rahab and lodged there." So this first question I came up, well, who is this Nun, Joshua's father? Well, there's a passage in 1 Chronicles 7, verse 26 and 27. It says, "Ladan, his son, Amihud, his son, Elishama, his son, and Nun, his son, and Joshua, his son." So we can see Nun is the son of Elishama, Joshua the son of Nun. That just gives a little bit of history that may not mean much to anybody, just because these names are kind of obscure. Again, you can always go and any type of Bible software that you might be using, you can type in Elishama. His name will come up. I'm not sure how to pronounce this guy's name properly. Anybody have a good guess better than Amihud? I got that one pretty good. Yeah. I always count on Pastor Nick for. So how about some other questions we might have? Why 2 men? Well, I don't know if there's a good answer to this, but you know, I thought about it. So why 2, not 12? Well, Joshua had sent out or was one of 12 once before, and the result of that really didn't go as well as they had hoped, or at least as well as Moses had hoped. So Joshua's kind of not so keen on that idea anymore of sending out 12. So he had some time on his hands prior to deciding to send these guys out, and he probably picked out 2 guys that he knew were going to do exactly what Joshua wanted them to do. Spy out the land, especially Jericho, bring a report, tell me what the news is. So he sent 2 men. 2 men is really all you really need. You got more than one, because now you got a second guy along with you for protection, for safety. Maybe you can look in 2 different directions at the same time. But also 2 is just enough. It's not too many, meaning you can still be stealthy. You can still get around without 12 guys trying to scramble around a city and draw commotion amongst yourselves. So this Acacia Grove, where is this Acacia Grove? Well, the exact location is still unknown, but it is somewhere in the plains of Moab, east of the Jordan River, and north of the Dead Sea. This is the same place that the Israelites also camped when Balak was trying to get Balaam to curse the Israelites. So if you go back in scripture a little bit more, there's several different times where Balak, a king, was paying Balak tons and tons of money, basically whatever he wanted, and he ended up trying to curse the Israelites 4 different times, and each time Balaam opened his mouth to try and curse the Israelites, nothing but good stuff came out of his mouth. And Balak was saying, "Dude, I'm giving you my half the kingdom here. Why aren't you doing what I asked you to do?" And Balaam warned him right at the very front that said, "Hey, I'll do what you're asking me, but all I'm going to really be able to do is whatever the Lord puts in my mouth." And all the Lord allowed him to do is speak good things over the Israelites. So this is that same place. If you Google, not Google, but if, well, you could Google it too, but if you look in your Bible software tools, whatever that may be, and type in Acacia Grove, again, you'll find this area. It could be a place called Shittim, which means the acacia trees. And this place was some distance from the Jordan, since it took a few days to get there. So there's a map here. So here's Jericho, where they're going to end up going. Here's the Jordan River. Here's this brown area, kind of this plain area. Moab is in this area. So here's this Abel Shittim. At least that's how I'm pronouncing it. So this is quite a distance away from, what's that? It's quite a ways away from the Jordan. And that's what Scripture tells us. Once they decide, finally, we're going to read about in chapter 3 in Joshua, that it's going to take them several days to get from their encampment there to get to the Jordan and then go to Jericho. So this is the place most likely, again, north of the Dead Sea, east of the Jordan, in the plains of Moab, where this acacia groves or the acacia trees once were. Most likely they're not there, so we don't have any proof positive. And then here's the route that the Israelite camp here in Abel Shittim, and they're going to leave here and make their way across the plains all the way over to Jericho, do what they're going to do, and then make their way back. I didn't look up, so I don't have a good feel for how many miles that may be. The two maps that I ended up pulling up didn't have a scale on them. But you kind of get geographically in your mind what we're going to be talking about when the spies leave the encampment and go to Jericho. So why did they want to go to Jericho? Well, Scripture tells them, go to Jericho. So that's where they go. That's where at least God told Joshua to tell these spies where to go. And they knew of Jericho. They knew of the land there that they were going to, at least of it. So they were told by Scripture to go to Jericho. This is I'm not sure what you call this, a little signage in Jericho, and they're claiming, you know, the oldest city of the world. And I came across that quite a few different times in Googling it and looking it up, that, you know, it is claimed to be one of the oldest cities. Maybe not the oldest, but one of the oldest cities in the world. Still being inhabited as well. It's one of the oldest ones in the world. So then the next pass, in this same verse still, we're still in verse 1. So we talked about Nun, the two men, the acacia grove, and Jericho. And then they come into this, it says, the house. So they went and came to the house of a harlot. So the house of Rahab. We know it's a house because Scripture in several different places mentions it's a house. And we're going to look at that in just a second. But the walls of Jericho, again, if you Google it, it's amazing what you can find on Google. But it's speculated that the walls of Jericho were somewhere between 30 and 40 feet tall. And it was a double-walled city. Most big cities were walled cities with a gate. We'll come across that in Scripture in just a second as well. But speculation was, again, the city is rubble now and built on top of, but it was speculated that this size of a city was probably at least a 10-foot thick wall separated by some 15, 20 feet, and then another 10 or 12, 15-foot thick wall, both of them 30 to 40 feet high. So that's kind of the situation where this house was built, because we're going to read in Scripture that her house was built on the wall. So in this gap, you know, if this was the gap, you can imagine coming down from the top of the 30 or 40 foot wall and running some big timbers across the two walls and laying down your plank boards to make a floor, and then up above you'd make a ceiling out of there. So inside of this area, wherever your floor up to the top of the wall and putting a ceiling up there, that was deemed to be her house. And she lived in the wall of the city of Jericho. So that's the mindset I want you to think about of what this might have looked like. I have a picture here of, this is not of the walls of Jericho, but it's the best example I could come up of where they, again, it's not me thinking that it was a double-walled city. It was others that speculated that it was a double-walled city. So here's a possible wall, and here's a possible wall. And imagine this was 10 feet thick, and this was 10 feet thick. And this was, you know, 15 feet or so across, and then 40 feet tall. So we can see this is the remains of some city and the exterior wall. And this is, over here, a different picture that I don't claim this is what we're actually thinking of, because notice there's a big space between these two walls. And I found other pictures, too, that showed houses built in that space, which would be 40 or 60 feet. But that's not what we're getting told in Scripture. So I say no to that, And why do I say no to that? If we go to verse 15, can someone read verse 15 for us? I think Kevin was going to do that if he was... Yep.
Then she let them down by a rope through the window, for her house was on the city wall.
Okay.
She dwelt on the wall.
Yep, so right there is what I mean by Scripture is telling us that it was kind of on or in the wall, and it wasn't that situation where her house was built on land between the walls. So that's kind of my reasoning of why and how this house was built, and there's several other commentaries that substantiate that. So why, let me go back to this passage here. So why did they come into the house of a harlot named Rahab? Well, we aren't told exactly, but please don't jump to your own conclusions of why the two spies may have gone into the house of a harlot. You can imagine one thing, but that's probably not the reason. The reason that I think that they ended up going to this house of the harlot was most likely they knew this place, her house, would probably, you know, it's kind of an attraction, mostly for men, but it's an area where you could probably get a great source of information. A lot of news traveled around this type of establishment. There was even speculation that her house may have been like a tavern, kind of a hangout place. Yeah, the prostitution was going on there, the house of a harlot. So there was that activity going on, but there also may have been other things going on where it was just a place where a lot of men gathered. So a lot of news could have been established there. And again, they were trying to spy out the land, especially Jericho, that we're reading about here in verse 1 still. So that's one reason why I think they found this place. So now, who is Rahab? Well, again, you can look up in Scripture quite a few different times you'll come across the name Rahab. She was a common prostitute, and they don't. It's interesting how Scripture doesn't try to hide that fact. And Scripture, in many different places, you know, doesn't cover up the ill repute or the bad deeds that many different characters in Scripture are known for. The biggest one that comes to mind right now is, you know, just King David. He was a great king, a friend of God, and so forth, and yet he had the husband of Bathsheba, who he took as wife, he essentially had him killed, murdered in the field. So that's just one thing that King David didn't do well. And there's other examples and stories throughout Scripture, too, that the Bible just doesn't whitewash or not even write about it at all, but it did write about it to let us know that even men of God are human, sinners, just like the rest of us. So it's... And in Rahab, she was a common prostitute or a harlot. The names are kind of synonymous. I don't know why she was, I guess, can't think of a different term besides just reduced to why she was reduced to prostitution. But chances are there's no mention that she has a husband. So she may have been married and he died or divorced, but there's no mention in Scripture of her having a husband. So maybe she was married at one point, and now she's on her own. Maybe her husband just died, and she just never remarried. If that was the case, or the other reason we're going to read about in Scripture next week is that she just has a big family. Actually, in the verse 13 that Joel read, it mentioned, you know, my mother, my father, my brothers, my sisters. So she's got a huge extended family that maybe she was kind of felt responsible. Maybe she was the oldest sister of this whole group of siblings, and she felt responsible for taking care of this probably fairly large family. So whatever the reason that she took to this profession, it was a means of income, a source of income for her. And at the end of this study and into next week, there's going to be another pretty cool tie-in, a source of income for her that I think, I'll save that for next week. So Rahab, of all the population of Jericho, reached out to the living God, and he in turn saved her and her family. We will read mostly next week. We'll have that whole dialogue between Rahab and the two spies and the vow that they end up making with one another, and how the spies claim that they're going to protect her if she does a certain thing, and she's not going to tell on the spies to the king and so on. They're going to keep a secret. They're going to pretty much make a pact, a vow together, and we'll read, you know, throughout the rest of the book of Joshua how They come in, they do take down Jericho, and they do save the family of Rahab and herself. So it's all going to turn out good in the end, but there's going to be some things that happen that like lying being done. And so we're going to talk about lying tonight. Rahab has a special significance also for Christians. I mentioned, you know, if you use Google her name or look it up in your software, she has a special significance that we're probably aware of. She is among the four women listed in Matthew's gospel as ancestors of the Jesus of Nazareth. The others are Ruth, Tamar, and Bathsheba. So if we go to Matthew chapter 1, verse 5, Solomon begot Boaz by Rahab, Boaz begot Obed by Ruth, and Obed begot Jesse. And who is Jesse? Father of David. So right there are some women that Rahab falls in line with as being women that are recognized in Scripture that all play a very prominent role in the lineage or the ancestry of David and then Jesus. So again, this is another one of those things that Scripture could have left out very easily. Can you imagine our Savior, our King, our Lord, having descended from a prostitute? But yes, this is the case. Yeah, and a Moabite. Yeah. All right, so a life lesson. First one for tonight. What we were before we came to the Lord does not shame the Lord. It glorifies Him. What we were before we came to the Lord does not shame the Lord. It glorifies Him. So you can imagine, think about your history. Think about history of a family member you know. May not be prostitution, per se, but we're all sinners. We may have stolen something. We may have a record of some sort. We may have done who knows what. That doesn't matter. If we have turned ourselves over to the Lord and accept Him as Lord, our Lord and Savior, that glorifies Him. We may not be yet who we desire to be, but praise God, we are not who we used to be. I just borrowed that from, I know I've heard Pastor David said it. I'm not sure who the original pastor of that phrase was, but it just came to mind when I was writing up this life lesson, so I thought I would tack it on there. Verse 2, and it was told the king of Jericho, saying, behold, men have come here tonight from the children of Israel to search out the country. So how did the king of Jericho find out so fast about these spies? I mean, it seems like the way you read verse 1 and then right into verse 2 is like immediate. How did the king find out so quick? Well, once again, the house of the harlot Rahab was a good source of information. Maybe there were just people outside waiting to get in, maybe. Or people just kind of lingering, loitering about the place. It's that type of institution where you may just be wondering, you know, people on the street, sweeping the street, or doing their wares, selling in the marketplace, whatever the case may be, they kind of got one eye on what they're doing and one eye on who's going into Rahab's house tonight. So they're just kind of looking around, and again, they probably also have, the king may have his spies about the city, not necessarily spies, but just people that are looking to earn a buck. You know, someone that is out there looking for a morsel of information that they could turn around and run to the king and get some money based on some information. We'll talk about that in just a second as well. So how did the king's men know that the men that they're talking about were from the children of Israel? The spies must have looked a little bit different. Remember, these spies, when they came into the city, obviously they were seen, but they came into the city and they must have looked a little bit different. Remember in Scripture it says that the men and women, the Israelites, wandered around the desert for 40 years and their clothes and their shoes did not wear out. Chances are they probably weren't making their clothes. They didn't need to make their clothes, but they didn't have the flax or the means or can't think of the things that are all necessary to build clothes, make clothes, but they didn't really need to. They had clothes when they left Egypt and then they wore them for 40 years. And they didn't wear out. And it kind of reminded me of the story of the, you know, Back to the Future, when Marty, he kind of goes back in time and he's got his newer leather coat on, his flashy, colorful clothes, and he goes back into whatever it was in the 1950s and 60s, and he just totally stood out because he had these newer, flashy clothes on that the people there were just like, whoa, why are you dressed that way? And that's kind of maybe how the Israelites stood out to the people in Jericho. Remember, the people in Jericho were kind of 40 years advanced as far as their clothing. That whatever the trends were in Jericho were not the way the Israelites were used to dressing. So they probably
40 years those trends would have come back.
Maybe. that does happen. So that's very possible that they really stood out just because of the way they were dressed. All right, verse 3. So the king of Jericho sent to Rahab, saying, "Bring out the men who have come to you, who have entered your house, for they have come to search out all the country." News travels fast in a small kingdom. The city of Jericho and the territory around it was ruled by this king. Makes me wonder if, again, this is where I brought out, you know, it makes me wonder if there were like snitches around the city just looking for those juicy morsels of information that they go to the king and sell him for pieces of information. So they were, news travels fast also in small cities. So that's kind of the idea here, is that's how the king was also able to find out this information so quickly. There's just a lot of people maybe with not a whole lot to do inside the city. All the work was being done maybe outside the city in the fields. So they're just hanging around and got to see some new folks come into town. It's better figure out who needs to know this information, see if I can make some money on it, is possibly what was happening. Verse 4. Then the woman took the two men and hid them. So she said, "Yes, the men came to me, but I did not know where they came from." Notice in verse 4 how Scripture tells us really how the Lord addresses Rahab. What do I mean by that? It says, "Then the woman took the two men." The Lord is really calling the Rahab a woman here. He's not saying "then the prostitute" or "then the Rahab" or "then the harlot." He's calling her a woman. He's not belittling her in any way. He's just saying "this woman." I thought that was kind of interesting. Just the way the words are used can be something very important to pay attention to.
And in Greek, that's a respectful term.
Woman? True. Yep. Okay. So also we see here that, yes, Rahab did lie to the men searching for the spies. So this is not a proof text or a basis to say that lying is condoned or accepted. Scripture does clearly condemn lying. So let's read a verse that mentions this, or two verses here. Leviticus 19:11 says, "You shall not lie," or "you should not steal, nor deal falsely, nor lie to one another." And then in Proverbs 12:22 it says, "Lying lips are an abomination to the Lord, but those who deal truthfully are his delight." Rahab's heroics do paint her kind of in a positive light. We'll see later that Joshua is going to end up praising her for what she has done. And both testaments of the Bible also praise and honor Rahab. Rahab's actions made her a part of God's people, ultimately placing her in the line of ancestry of David and Jesus, as I mentioned a minute ago. Rahab's actions were also a part of the conquest of Canaan, you know, this area that they're going into where Jericho is. Her actions were a part of allowing the conquest of Canaan, and especially Jericho, to take place. And you know what? God commissioned and blessed all of that. For all of this to happen, God allowed it to happen. So he allowed her to say what she said in an effort to allow the conquest of Canaan to take place. So if that's the case, and we know that she did tell a lie, a fib, whatever you want to call it, her lie was one of three things. Her lie was not a sin, or her lie was a sin but excusable, or her lie was a sin and inexcusable. It's basically the only three explanations I could come up with. Number one, we're kind of already saying that it was a sin, but now we kind of fall in between explanation two or three. And I wasn't going to go down the path of trying to illustrate or expound on Numbers 2 and 3 there, but you kind of have to reconcile in your own mind, was it a sin and excusable, or was it a sin and inexcusable? It sounds like, even though it's not easy to say, it seems like it's falling into number 2 area there, and God, again, allowed it to take place. Well, he allows a lot of things to take place, not all things that are good either. Note that the Bible praises Rahab because of her faith, though, her faith in God, not because of her lying. So we're going to read other scriptures here in just a second that she was praised, like I said, in both testaments of Scripture, and it wasn't because of her lying. It doesn't mention anywhere else about how she lied, and this is why we're praising her. It's because of her faith. So let's read in Hebrews 11:31, "By faith the harlot Rahab did not perish with those who did not believe, when she had received the spies with peace." Hebrews chapter 11 is also known as the Hall of Faith. She is mentioned there with many other well-known men and women. I'd encourage you to read that chapter at some point in time if you haven't read it recently. Also, James chapter 2, 25 says, "Likewise, was not Rahab the harlot also justified by works when she received the messengers and sent them out another way?" So again, whoever the author of Hebrews was praised Rahab, and so did James. Life lesson. Rahab, like the rest of us, had a mixed character, but she believed in God and strove to honor him and his people. She was a heroine of the faith. She was a mother in the line of Jesus. So pretty impressive, even though she ended up telling this white lie, little fib. Verse 5. "And it happened as the gate was being shut, when it was dark, that the men went out. Where the men went, I do not know. Pursue them quickly, for you may overtake them." All major cities in Canaan were walled and had a large gate for protection. So this gate that's being mentioned here was something that should have been expected, and again, with these big stone walls around the perimeter of your city, there had to be ways to get in and ways to get out. And Pastor David has mentioned in several times going through some of our Old Testament scriptures, and when he went through the book of Joshua years ago, you know that in even Jerusalem, for those of you that have been to Jerusalem, you can go through, I don't know if there's still 12 city gates around the city of Jerusalem that are still open. I know the East Gate is all stoned up, you can't get through it, but there's several other gates, archways and stuff, and they would have had big, huge doors in there, or that would have opened up with the big, huge timbers behind them, you know, like you see in the movies that they try to break in, or it may have had a metal gate that went up, I'm not sure, but all major cities had these walls around them with big gates in the walls that they would close at night, just like it says here, that at nighttime they would close these city gates for the city's protection during the night. And then they wouldn't open them up again during the night at all for any reason until daylight the next morning is when those gates would be opened once again. Verse 6. "But she had brought them up to the roof and hidden them with stalks of flax, which she had laid in order on the roof." So most houses had a flat roof. The flax was laid out on the roof for drying. And flax, if you didn't know, another name of it is linseed, and it's also one of the oldest known fibers to man. The flax stacks would dry and crack open eventually after they were soaked in water for 2 to 3 weeks. So there's pictures online where you can see where they cut the flax down with a sickle or some sort of heart cutting them, and they would bind them up in stalks and stack them in the field, and then they would have to take these stalks and then bring them back to town. And this is the work that Rahab was doing. She was at least getting this flax, and then she would have to haul it through stairs, whatever means, to get up to her house. It was 30 or 40 feet up in the air, and then she'd go up on top of her roof and lay out this flax. And it says here she laid out this flax in order on the roof. But this flax would be having to be soaked in water, and then it would be spread out for it to be baked by the sun so that it would get hot and dry, and eventually the stalks would crack, and you would open up these stalks, and that's where there'd be this linen fiber inside of there, and that would be extracted, and then that linen fiber would be collected, and eventually enough of it would be woven together to make clothes and sometimes rope that we're going to read about in just a second as well. Not that this was what we talked about her house looking like, but other houses that weren't built on or in the wall, like Rahab's house, they often had these flat areas on the roof, again, for a lot of times sleeping at night, especially in the summertime when it would get really hot and they don't have the AC going like we do now. They need that 360 ventilation going on. They'd go up on the roof, as Pastor David was talking about a couple weeks ago. They'd go up there and they lay out in the dark and be just looking up at the stars. We remember when we watched that movie? Anybody remember what the title of that movie was? Star of Bethlehem. And if you haven't watched that movie, that was a really good movie. And he really went into deep thought about why people knew a lot more about stars back then than we do, because they spent so many hours underneath the stars looking up at them and actually paying attention to their movements from one night to the next night to the next night as they fell asleep under the stars, literally, on the roof of their house. But here are the stalks of flax that, again, were gathered from the field after laborious work to harvest them, and they would eventually, again, soaked in water, laid out to dry, soaked in water, laid out to dry, soaked in water, laid out to dry for several weeks before they would crack open and then be able to harvest the fiber inside of it. So I say here, flax was harvested to get the strands of fiber inside the stalks. The fiber was used to make clothing and rope. Verse 7, it mentions, okay, let's read it. Then the men pursued them by the road to the Jordan, to the fords. And as soon as those who pursued them had gone out, they shut the gate. So this is the gate again that we just got done mentioning. But I wasn't sure what a ford was, so I went to get a definition of it. A ford is a shallow place with good footing where a river or stream may be crossed by wading or getting in a vehicle. They didn't have a vehicle, but nowadays we'd call a ford, you know, if we could get in a vehicle and all, we'd go through it, the water would be shallow enough that all we would get wet is the wheels of our vehicle as we're going through it. So it was very shallow. So you could easily wade across this area too. And this is probably where the spies chose a very shallow area to cross, because we're going to, in the next chapter, we're going to read about how at this time the Jordan River was at a flood stage. It was over going its banks. But evidently there was still a place where there was shallow in spots. A ford is mostly a natural phenomenon in contrast to a low water crossing, which is an artificial bridge that allows crossing a river or stream when water is low. So this was just a natural phenomenon, maybe where in a bend or something where sand had been washed up in a certain area and it just kind of caused a sandbar, a very shallow area. So there's what a ford is. Seems like every verse you ever read in the Bible, you should be able to find something in that verse. As Pastor David has said, and you know, there's no filler, there's no nothing in the Bible that's not there for a reason. And I'm sure there's more to each verse that I'm not extracting from it. That maybe you can ask your own self questions and go dig more information about it. Verse 8 and 9. Now before they lay down, she came up to them on the roof and said to the men, I know that the Lord has given you the land, and the terror of you has fallen on us, and that all the inhabitants of the land are faint-hearted because of you. Imagine the view. So now they're up on the roof, and Rahab has decided to go back up on the roof after she sent the king's men away and telling her a little white lie. She went back up on the roof to try to catch the men before they fell asleep amongst the flax that she had laid up on the roof. But can you imagine the view that these men must have had up there on the roof? Just kind of close your eyes if you need to, but you imagine you're 30, 40 feet up in the air. It's dark now. The stars are out. And you're on this wall, and if you kind of roll over and look down to the right, maybe you're looking down into the city. Remember, these walls are on the perimeter of the city, so you can look down and see the whole city of Jericho laid out before them, however big it might have been. So they kind of got a good feel for how big Jericho was, because they're up at the highest point of the city right now, on top of the wall, on top of a roof. And then if they roll back over to the other side and they look out towards the Jordan, east of the city, we got this plain, the plain of Moab, and looking out over there in the direction, maybe still being able to see the encampment of the Israelites, I don't know, 5-6 miles away, whatever the distance is. Jericho's west of the Jordan. The encampment was east of the Jordan. So if they were looking in, happened to be looking in that direction, what might they have seen, or what would they have had to seen at night at this point in time? Fire in the sky. That pillar of fire was still, we haven't been told that it's not happening anymore. So can you imagine, it says here that these inhabitants are faint-hearted. They are terrified of the Israelites. They have gotten so close now that they can see the pillar of fire in the sky every night as they go to bed themselves. And they should be able to see that on the house of Rahab right now when they're looking in that direction. I can't imagine what that could have had to be like for them to be encamped over there and to see that every night. And for 40 years, they've heard the stories of what the Israelites have done. We're going to talk about that in just a second as well, too. So the pillar of fire at night was still visible. Because of this word, notice how here we have the word Lord, capital L, capital O-R-D. That's the Lord's name being used specifically, and she is saying that, Yahweh, that Lord is being used there, and it's Rahab speaking this. It may imply that Rahab had come to the faith in the living God. There's no definitive proof of that, but she's using his name when she's talking to these two spies. And next week, I'm going to maybe give possible more information why I think maybe Rahab was a believer because of the things that she's involved in that we're going to read about with this harvesting of the flax and so forth. I think it's a possible cool correlation that she is already a believer. So think about that. And again, this is conjecture because we're not told that she was a believer or that she came to the faith. And I hate to even say that. I don't like to ever bring up conjecture if I can avoid it. But I'm just kind of throwing that out there because we have her actually using the Lord's name here specifically. So Israel's reputation had come before the Israelites even showed up. Because it says here, remember in verse 9, and that all the inhabitants of the land are faint-hearted because of you guys. You guys have terrified us. And why is that? She's going to share that with us here in just a second. Remember the reports of the Israelites' deliverance out of Egypt and their wanderings for 40 years had spread throughout all the nations that they've are about to come into now. And the word faint-hearted here in Hebrew means to melt away or to dissolve. So these men and women's hearts are just melted almost. They're just terrified of what the Israelites are eventually, we're going to find out, doing to them in their city. So this is pretty interesting. Life lesson. The fact that non-Israelites came to true faith indicates that God's great mercy reached other nations. His great mercy reached other nations. His great mercy is still experienced today. Praise the Lord. All right. Verse 10. For we have heard how the Lord, there it is once again, dried up the water of the Red Sea for you when you came out of Egypt, and what you did to the two kings of the Amorites who were on the other side of the Jordan, Sihon and Og, whom you utterly destroyed. Rahab recounts two of the most memorable deliverances of the Israelites. The Red Sea crossing, remember this was 40 years ago, and it's still in their remembrance now, and that she's bringing it up and reminding them, oh, do you remember when you crossed the Red Sea 40 years ago? We're still talking about that, by the way, here. We're terrified of you, because, and also mention, you know, how the skeptics have said, well, maybe it was just a reed sea or a little swamp area. But she's calling it the Red Sea, and it's no small thing that the Egyptian army died in this Red Sea. And she's recognizing that. So she's not saying that, oh, that was just one little thing. But we know what God did. Is he spread the sea open, and you walked through on dry ground, and the Egyptians all died in this Reed Sea or the swamp. No, it wasn't that. It was a sea. Because Scripture is also going to tell us that there was walls of water on either side. We're going to read that in just a second here. And so that was 40 years ago, the crossing of the Red Sea. But then also we have the incidents of utterly destroying Sihon and Og. And this was recent history. So she quotes two things, one from way in the past and one from right here in current times, at least to her. So Exodus 14, 21 through 23 says, "Then Moses stretched out his hand over the sea, and the Lord caused the sea to go back by a strong east wind all that night, and made the sea into dry land, and the waters were divided. So the children of Israel went into the midst of the sea on the dry ground, and the waters were a wall to them on their right hand and on their left. And the Egyptians pursued and went after them into the midst of the sea, all Pharaoh's horses, his chariots, and his horsemen." So again, imagine the separation in the Red Sea of being probably a mile wide, where the waters were backed up to the city of Adam and then down to the area of Jericho for, again, close to 2 million people maybe, because I think they did the census and it was around 600,000 men. Add in their wife, so that's 1.2 million. Add in their kids, so 1.5 to 1.2 million people. You can't just do that single file. They're probably stretched out quite wide and then marching across the Red Sea on dry ground between two walls of water on either side. To me, that'd be so cool to be able to walk up to the wall of water and kind of stick my hand in there maybe, or see if there, I could see fish in the wall of the water, what was going on. But that would have been so cool to see that. And she's recounting this to them. Also, Numbers 21 and 23 says, "But Sihon would not allow Israel to pass through his territory. So Sihon gathered all his people together and went out against Israel in the wilderness, and he came to Jahaz and fought against Israel. Then Israel defeated him with the edge of the sword and took possession of his land from Arnon to the Jabbok as far as the people of Ammon, for the border of the people of Ammon was fortified." And then finally, Numbers 21:33, "And they turned and went up by the way of Bashan. So Og, king of Bashan, went out against them and all of his people to battle at Edrei. Then the Lord said to Moses, 'Do not fear him, for I have delivered him into your hand with all his people and his land. And you shall do to him as you did to Sihon, king of the Amorites, who dwelt at Heshbon.' So they defeated him, his sons, and all his people, until there was no survivor left him, and they took possession of his land." Very interesting how they did all this, and she's recounting this. Verse 11, "And as soon as we heard these things," Rahab is still talking, "our hearts melted, neither did there remain any more courage in anyone because of you, for the Lord your God, He is God in heaven above and on earth below." So we just read a couple scriptures about Sihon and Og. So what is some more information about these two kings, these giants? Well, the Bible remembers Og as belonging to the race of giants, who was left of the remaining Rephaim. And special attention is paid to the description of Og's huge iron bed. If you were to go look in Deuteronomy chapter 3, verse 11, it says, "For only Og, king of Bashan, remained of the remnant of the giants. Indeed, his bedstead was an iron bedstead. Is it not in Rabbah of the people of Ammon?" So it's still there to this day when this verse of Joshua was written. 9 cubits is its length, and 4 cubits its width, according to the standard cubit. According to different references, you'll see a different designation of how much a cubit is, but it's usually from your fingertip to your elbow, and that's roughly 18 inches on most men. So you always had your measuring device around with you. If you wanted to measure something, your span from there to there is roughly 18 inches. So if we do the math on 9 cubits and 4 cubits, that means that his bed was 6 feet wide, which is maybe a good king-size bed, but this is just one guy sleeping in it maybe, and 13 and a half feet long. That's the 9 cubits dimension. So 6 by 13 and a half. So you know, when I'm laying in my bed, I have maybe a little bit up here past my head and maybe a little bit down past my feet. So if that was the case with Og, he was maybe 12 feet tall, 12 and a half feet tall in a 13 and a half foot long bed. So he was...
Is that a reference of what people just said?
The way I'm pronouncing it is the Rephaim. Yeah. The the Nephilim and the Rephaim, aren't they both races of giants? I know the okay.
The Nephilim were destroyed before the flood.
Before the flood.
They're part of where the speculation or the interpretation of the scripture is that the sons of God had sexual relations with
the Nephilim. Wipe that out.
So
right.
This is another outburst of giants. The Reverend, they got some other tribal names, Anakin.
Yep.
There's one funny one, Anakin or something like that.
Yep.
Yeah, it's like
a
place all in the Zazuni.
So there was what, maybe at least three or four races of giants after the flood, and this Rephaim was one of them. All right, so note in both of these verses that we just got done reading, where Rahab says, "We heard." I think I tried to highlight it here. So in verse 11, it says, "We heard," there in the green. And then back here in verse 10, "We have heard." So in verse 10 and verse 11, it says, "We have heard." So, is there another scripture verse that kind of reminds you of we have heard or hearing is important? How would I say that in a better way to? Yes. So what's that name? What's the address for that verse? There we go. So Romans 10:17. So then faith comes by hearing, and hearing by the word of God. So I just thought that was interesting that she said, "We have heard," twice, two verses in a row. And it just reminded me of that scripture verse, Romans 10:17. And every time, not every time, whenever I'm hearing people talk sometimes, especially here at church, they'll say something that's, they're not trying to quote scripture, but they'll kind of paraphrase something in their own words. And I'll hear him say that, and that kind of makes me, that's part of a scripture verse almost. And I try to think of it in my mind, and I may say something to them right then and there about it, or I may just recollect, you know, that, oh, they were really trying to share a little bit of scripture with me there, that even though they didn't say the whole verse or give the address. But for those of you that have been through School of Discipleship, SOD, that's one thing I try to remind people during that first week of classes, you're going to have to be memorizing lots of scripture in this class, and it's really important to try and correlate or remember, tie together the actual verse that you're memorizing and its address, its location in the Bible. So that way, when you're trying to share something with a person, remember in SOD, you learn seven different verse passages of the Romans Road, and really you can lead someone to the Lord with one or two of those verses. You don't even need all seven, depending on who you're talking to, what the situation is. So therefore, when you're sharing one of those scriptures, you want to also be able to share with them what that scripture reference is, so that way they know it's not just a cool saying by Tom or something that I'm trying to quote. It's the word of God that I'm quoting to you, not just a Tom cliche, something like that. So no. The hearing and by the word of God. And finally, we're getting into the last two scripture passages. Now therefore I beg you, swear to me by the Lord, since I have shown you kindness, that you also will show kindness to my father's house, and give me a true token, and spare my father, my mother, my brothers, my sisters, and all they have, and deliver our lives from death. So even though to swear in God's name was a serious matter, the two spies agreed to Rahab's request. In James chapter 5, verse 12, it says, "But above all, my brethren, do not swear, either by heaven or by earth or with any oath. Let your yes be yes and your no, no, lest you fall into judgment." So James was kind of saying here, James is not saying a believer can't make an oath in court, for instance. Sometimes we have to go in court and put your left hand in the Bible and raise your right hand and swear. That type of thing is okay. James isn't also saying that we're invoking God as a witness to some significant statement. Instead, James here in this verse is reminding us to watch what we say. Just be careful about what we say at all times. We should not use God's name in a reckless manner, and we should be careful to speak the truth at all times as well. This verse also mentions a token. What is a token? What is meant here, I did the little collinear thing in my Blue Letter Bible app to see what the Hebrew word token means. So it's like a distinguishing mark, a banner, or a remembrance, or a monument. So she was asking for something kind of tangible, other than just the words of this vow that she was making with them, that they were going to uphold this promise that they were kind of making with each other. And we'll talk more about this next week when it starts in verse 14 through the end of the chapter. So she was asking for this token. And then in verse 13, it says, "And spare my father, my mother, my sisters, and my brothers, all that they have, and deliver our lives." Oops. Lost it, didn't I? What was the last? Where'd it go? Anyhow, that was the last verse. But in verse 13 it says, "And spare my father, my brother, my sisters," and so on. She was kind of making what we call a big ask here. She wants a guarantee that her whole family will be spared when they come back and take the city. Not if, but when they come back and take the city.